One thing that the Pokémon Mystery Dungeon series is known for is the fact that despite its very committed and quite vocal fanbase, critics have never seemed to like the games. This split reception has been relatively consistent across the series' lifespan, with one exception. Pokémon Mystery Dungeon Gates to Infinity has always been a bit of a black sheep amongst the franchise, the bad one, so to speak. And for the longest time, I knew it as the one I skipped. And after all these years, I finally took a chance to sit down and give this game a go. And all I have to say is, it is a fantastic game and is most certainly worthy of the title of Pokémon Mystery Dungeon. Although it's far from the best that the series has to offer. I've already covered the development history of the series in my video on Rescue Team DX, so I'm going to try to not repeat myself too much, but I'm going to give you a brief recap just in case you didn't watch that video. The series was developed by Spike Chunsoft, who were also known as the developers of the early Dragon Quest games. Series creator Koichi Nakamura created it with the intent of being a more approachable version of the game Rogue. The series, while fairly niche, had its fair share of fans, including Tsunekazu Ishihara of the Pokémon Company, who had previously worked with Chunsoft and claims to have always wanted to find a way to connect the Mystery Dungeon series with Pokémon, with that finally happening in 2005 with Red and Blue Rescue Team. The game we're talking about today, Pokémon Mystery Dungeon Gates to Infinity, is the third title released worldwide, and the fourth title in Japan, because Pokémon Mystery Dungeon WiiWare is a thing that I constantly have to remind myself exists every time I make a video like this. Like, seriously? Raise your hand if you knew these games existed. Returning to Gates to Infinity, the game was released in November 2012 in Japan and March 2013 in America, just a few months after the launch of Black and White 2 in both territories. There were some notable changes to the series with this entry as well, most notably the shift to 3D, as this was the first title to be released on the 3DS. This was also the first entry to not be released as two separate versions, instead just releasing a single game. Ishihara explained the reasoning for this change in an Iwata Asks interview, saying, "Simply put, we felt that one package was enough. The game already contains a number of different elements, including an enjoyable story, an adventure that involves scanning round objects, cooperative play, street pass features, and more. We therefore thought it was simpler to just have one version, an ultimate version, if you will." Frankly, this was a good move on their part. Red and Blue Rescue Team made sense with the two versions being on two separate systems, but after that, the level of interconnectivity between the versions just wasn't enough to justify releasing two games. The game ultimately sold 1.3 million copies, which, while only slightly less than the numbers Explorers of Skypold, was a far cry from how Red and Blue Rescue Team and the original Explorers of Time and Darkness had performed. In fact, it is the second worst-selling Pokémon Mystery Dungeon title in existence, just edging out Rescue Team DX, which, due to only coming out a couple of months ago, could easily wind up eclipsing it in the end. Now that we've got the baseline information out of the way, it's time to go through the game and see if it's really the ultimate version that Ishihara claims it is. Spoiler alert, it's not. When booting up the game and starting a new save file, it's apparent that this game is quite different from what came before it. It starts in the same typical psychedelic void that precedes all Mystery Dungeon games, but this time, you hear a voice calling for help and outright saying that you're needed to save the world. Well, that didn't take long. Not even a few minutes in, and the game is already asking me to save the world from destruction. Either way, we're treated to this scene of a Muna being chased by a Hydreigon before literally being dropped in. The most significant change here, besides the more immediate appearance of story content, is the changes to the starter Pokémon, or rather, how your starter is selected. You see, previously the games made you take a quiz to determine what Pokémon you get, implying that the Pokémon you become is a reflection of who you are as a person. At least, that's the impression I got from the fact that the only other human-turned Pokémon we see in the entire series is Gengar. But I digress. Here, however, the game has been simplified, instead just asking you to pick a Pokémon, which introduces us to the other significant change in this game. What you'll notice when you're presented with your starter choice is how few starter options there are to pick from. What do I mean by that? In both of the previous games, you were able to play as any of the starters from all of the generations that were introduced up to that point, plus some additional Pokémon like Skitty or Riolu. This time, however, your options are limited to just 5 Pokémon: Pikachu, Snivy, Tepig, Oshawott, and Axew. This immediately tips you off to the fact that the game has a severely reduced roster. There are only 144 Pokémon in this game, with the selection strongly favoring the 5th generation. The first 4 generations only have 31 Pokémon to share between them, with all the rest being Gen 5. And if you know anything about math, you would also notice that not even all of the Generation 5 Pokémon are in this game. What we tend to find more generally is that this game is somewhat lacking, at least mechanically speaking. For one, the belly mechanic has been removed, which is neither here nor there. Honestly, I don't really care about whether or not this mechanic is present, but it seems to be indicative of an overall simplification of the game's systems. We see more of this in the way that jobs are handled this time around. Instead of being able to do as many jobs as you want in a single dungeon at a time, you can only do one. This slows down the overall gameplay and flow of rewards quite unnecessarily, and frankly, seems like padding. The game's biggest shortcoming, and the thing that frankly makes it undeserving of the distinction of the ultimate version, is the lack of content and the presence of Day 1 DLC. In both previous games, you unlocked these rather elaborate post-game questlines that could easily double, if not triple, your playtime. Gates to Infinity has a single dungeon that you can access that has new story content, and all that really happens is it gives you the ability to get your starter back after they disappear, because the writers decided it might be a little bit more impactful to have the separation last a little longer than 10 minutes. Beyond that, you can go to some optional dungeons and fight some legendaries, none of which you can recruit, by the way. So yeah, I find it hard to give the label of ultimate version to a game like this. You have basically nothing to do after you save the world besides one dungeon. The story, for all intents and purposes, ends after the credits. And given that the previous games had so much to offer after the credits, the game can't help but feel lacking. For all of its faults though, the game does have its fair share of interesting new features that enhance the experience. The biggest of these is the V-Wave, which powers up a random type each day, adding another consideration the player will need to make when building their team for the day. Also, I don't know why, but I love it every time Victini is on screen. You'd think that this would get annoying, but I just kept finding myself laughing at it every time. We also have the Mysteriosity mechanic, which is unlocked after completing the main story. This basically makes it so that random events may occur when entering a floor. The biggest shame is that the game waits to introduce this fairly interesting mechanic until after there isn't much left to do in the game. It's pretty much over by the point that you unlock this feature. In addition, the game also takes the edge off of losing, causing you to only lose a few items instead of everything. This is a change that I honestly wish was kept, because it makes the games just that much more approachable. In the event that you need to stock up in the middle of a batch of story dungeons, you're very easily able to do that with the companion mode, which allows you to switch over control to one of your other Pokémon, giving you access to jobs and facilities whenever you need it. This is likely present due to the fact that previous titles, most notably Explorers, often went on for hours without being able to visit the hub town, something that this game does quite a bit itself in the later half. The game also removed the IQ mechanic, thank God, replacing them with team skills, which now apply to your whole party instead of just one Pokémon, making them much easier to get, and making any one team member less of an investment. Think of these as a bit of a precursor to the rare qualities found in Rescue Team DX. One major improvement this game inherits from the main series games is infinite use TMs. If you are a Pokémon fan, you already know why this is great. This feature, when it was introduced in Black and White, was a godsend for the series, and I am so glad that they never went back after this. This actually goes well with one of the game's best new mechanics, move ranks, something that I mentioned very briefly in my last video. Basically, the game gives you these items called team badges, which makes it so your moves can be upgraded when you use them. That's not all though, as because of the badges, if you upgrade a skill with one Pokémon, then it's upgraded for the entire team, which allows you to take full advantage of multi-use TMs, which really encourages varied party usage, along with changes to the experience system, which cause all Pokémon in your party to gain experience, regardless to whether or not they've battled. This again is an improvement over Explorers, as it means your random recruits don't get weaker because you're stuck doing story with only your core team. The reason this was called the ultimate version in the first place was due to new mechanics that were introduced that took advantage of the 3DS hardware. The game utilized AR technology on the 3DS, allowing you to scan any circular object in the real world in order to find a dungeon, which is a pretty interesting mechanic and makes this game one of the few 3DS games that I know of to actually utilize this feature. When asked about this, Ishihara mentioned how he wanted to use some kind of AR feature for the game. I wanted to create a system where scanning something using AR causes the nature of a dungeon to change, but also using AR in a way similar to what we did with Pokémon Dream Radar and Pokédex 3D. For example, there may be a manhole cover near you that looks just like a dungeon entrance. I wondered whether we could create a game in which players could think, the monsters in that sewer are really tough. The game also uses the Street Pass function for rescues, making you less reliant on directly knowing people who have the game than you were previously. Ishihara notes that, in the past, the process of helping a player would have involved going to the location where they were defeated. This time around, however, things are much easier. Just walk around with your Nintendo 3DS system in your pocket, and you may find yourself being helped out by another player at any moment. This is a good idea in theory, but the problem is that Street Pass was really only a thing in Japan. If you lived pretty much anywhere else, you probably would only be able to do this at a convention like PAX, and I have a feeling you won't be going to those anytime soon. So again, it's a neat idea, just not for everyone. Especially players like me, who are enjoying the game for the first time over 7 years after launch, when Nintendo has since abandoned the 3DS. Now that I've covered all of the changes to the mechanics, both good and bad, let's get to the part that is all good. In case you didn't know, that's the story. As per usual, the story is impeccable. If you've played these games before, the story is fairly familiar, but with some new twists. Lead writer Shinichiro Tomie expressed his desire to change things up in order to still be fresh for veteran players. The question was what to change and what to keep. The first thing to note is that the classic tale, the tale of friendship between the main character and their partner, has not changed. Just because it's a classic tale, doesn't mean it was easy though. Classic stories are easy to understand. To put it bluntly, there is justice, there is evil. The world is in danger, a hero appears to save the world is saved, everyone's happy. That kind of pattern. It's crucial that your stories remain both unpredictable and plausible. It's difficult to make very common stories interesting. Having said that, if you do pull off a classic story successfully, it's one of the most powerful types of story there is. That's why it's something I've tried to do throughout the Pokémon series. We see several points where the game tries to implement this unpredictability by subverting some of the tropes that it had previously established. A notable example is the way the game handles its villains. Typically, the big bads in the Mystery Dungeon series have been Pokémon that already look kind of evil. In Rescue Team, we had Gengar, and in Explorers, we had Dusknoir and Darkrai. In this game, one of the prominent villains is Muna. Yes, as in the cute little pink floral thing. Does anyone actually know what Muna is supposed to be? One moment. Alright, apparently Bulbapedia is claiming that it's based off of a Japanese incense burner, and also a tapir, just like Drowsy is. Huh. I would never have guessed that. Anyways, if you remember, it's Muna that we see being chased at the start of the game, and we're led to believe that she's the one who needs help. The characters even set out to rescue her later in the story, only for the game to pull the old switcheroo on us and have Muna be evil, with Hydreigon actually being the good guy. This is actually a slightly better way to make things unexpected than what we previously had. Since it was kinda obvious Dusknoir was going to be the bad guy, it wasn't just me who thought this, right? What's great this time around is that the game doesn't really give you too many hints that this is coming, and the hints that it does give are subtle enough that you probably won't suspect anything on a first playthrough. I probably wouldn't even have known to check the opening if it wasn't for the fact that the game literally points it out to you after the twist. Another major change we see to the game is the fact that for the first time in series history, we have a final boss that isn't a legendary Pokémon, or even a Pokémon at all. The boss fight isn't that great though, it's basically just a one-on-one slapfest where the question is more so whether or not you have enough healing items to survive long enough to knock it out. And even then, the game doesn't reset its HP if you lose, and you're just brought straight back to the start of the fight, so there really isn't any way to lose this battle. For all intents and purposes, Kyurem is the last boss, but thematically, this thing is the ultimate challenge that our characters need to overcome. And from a narrative perspective, this thing is kind of a brilliant idea. The central theme of the story is that negativity is corrosive, not just to the individual, but the society as a whole. You know the saying, one bad apple can spoil the whole bunch? That's basically the core idea that the story tries to get across. The game establishes early on that Pokémon are growing more and more hostile towards each other, and that tensions between Pokémon are continually rising. The game demonstrates the way in which negativity is transitive. The first example of this is the character of Girder, a master carpenter who was at the top of his game until he was injured in some kind of accident. After he recovered, he found that he'd lost his touch, but despite that, he put his heart into his creation. Eventually, he takes a job where the customer wasn't satisfied and destroyed the home he built, calling it junk. This really discourages Girder, leading him to eventually give up carpentry and take to a life scamming Pokémon instead, not seeing an honest life as being worth living at all. We later see the same concept come in through the character of Virizion, who is inherently distrustful of other Pokémon due to being abandoned by her friend Keldeo after being sent a letter from him saying that he left just to get away from her. In the end, we learn that Keldeo's letter was actually a lie meant to protect Virizion due to plot stuff, but Keldeo expresses pretty clearly that he realized the harm that the letter caused to his friend and how it had damaged her outlook on life. In both cases, we see individuals who are emotionally hurt by others, leading to a bleak outlook on life. We also end up seeing this with the villains, who mention that they are trying to stop the player from saving the world because of mistreatment they themselves received, deeming the world to be beyond saving. Again, we see negative treatment towards the characters, leading them to adopt a negative outlook on life. In fact, the overall negative outlook of these Pokémon is the main source of danger in the world. It's not a meteor like in Rescue Team or the collapse of time itself like in Explorers. In this game, the ultimate source of evil is that thing from earlier, known as the Bitter Cold, a mysterious force born from the collective negativity of the Pokémon in the world. And it's grown so strong from said negativity that it basically threatens to destroy everything. This is the element that makes this story so interesting to me, even though it's just a giant snowflake that never talks. If you've been on the internet for any period of time, God have mercy on your soul, you may already have an inkling as to how negativity can spread like wildfire. On sites like YouTube.com, it is far more lucrative to be negative than it is to be positive. Something that YouTuber Jim Sterling, someone who frequently produces negative content, talked about in a recent video. He mentions how a video where he says something positive tends to get half the views as a negative one does. Something video essayist Lindsay Ellis echoed in a video whose view count literally proves Jim's point. And it's not just the world of thing bad, blank is garbage and here's why media criticism where we see this either. We've also seen one particular niche on YouTube do extremely well and serve as one of the purveyors of negativity online. Drama channels. People like call-out videos. They like seeing people with large platforms get knocked down a peg. And while all the videos that spread love and appreciation of things get buried under just this deluge of negative content. This is just the nature of the game here on YouTube. The algorithm, for some reason, seems to like negativity, and has for years. And given the monopolistic nature of the company that owns this website, I don't see that changing anytime soon. And yes, I understand that being positive is kinda hard right now. The world is on fire, and it all seems pretty hopeless. I mean, what can we do right now to stop the bad things? I certainly don't see anything. In Gates to Infinity, we actually see this same idea that the world is doomed make the bitter cold get stronger. Yet, there is one thing that is able to break all of that. Hope. When the player manages to shatter the core of the bitter cold, it causes the evil swirling vortex in the sky to briefly disappear, leaving a rainbow behind. Even though it's brief, it manages to give the Pokémon enough of a glimmer of hope to maintain positivity long enough for our heroes to save the day. And sometimes, that's all it takes. The world may seem desolate, and it may seem like everything is going to end. But we have to look for and always cling to the hope that everything will be alright. We need to believe in each other, trust people, as that makes the world better. And if we don't, well, that literally causes the end of the world. Okay, not quite literally, but if we lose all hope, then we'll definitely accelerate the process of destruction because no one's gonna stand up to try to stop it. What makes this narrative so compelling is that we see ways in which our heroes are able to break through the negativity and become a force for good, showing that while negativity does tend to spread around quite a bit, positivity can spread around just as much, and can be a just as, if not more, powerful force. We see time and again characters have their perspectives changed for the better because of our heroes. Their determination allows the other characters to realize that there is good in the world, and that maybe you shouldn't just give in to despair. This is best exemplified by this little bit of dialogue from Gerder to Virizion after you save Dunsparce. "I used to be the same as you once. I didn't have any faith left in the world. But unlike you, my lovely, I crossed the line and did bad things to other Pokémon. Until quite recently, in fact. But meeting the player and their partner, it changed the way I thought about things. Every time I see those two, I think this world isn't worth giving up on yet." Gates to Infinity is definitely flawed. I won't deny that. But if you're able to look past that, we have a pretty good story about hope and how negativity is a destructive force. Based on that story alone, it definitely holds a place among the other Mystery Dungeon titles as a great time with lots of feels. It's got fantastic characters, hilarious dialogue, and a core message that truly resonates. Thank you for making it to the end. If you enjoyed this video, why don't you give it a like and check out my previous video on Pokémon Mystery Dungeon Rescue Team DX. Also, don't forget to subscribe and click on the little bell icon so you know when I upload my next video. But until next time, guys, peace.